Oh, your blood is the better word. Because your blood paid it all. And it continues to flow. Oh, there is nothing like your blood, God.
Nothing like it. Oh, Jesus. Yeah, yeah. Your blood is healing every wound, and your blood is making all things new. Your blood, it speaks a better word. See, your blood is the measure of my worth. It's more than I deserve. Your blood, it speaks a better word. It speaks a better word. And it's singing out with life. And it's shouting down the lines. And it echoes through the night. The precious blood. It speaks a better word. It speaks a better word. Oh, your blood is the robe of righteousness. Your blood, my hope and my defense. Your blood forever covers me.
Yeah,
it forever covers me.
Right, the precious blood of Christ speaks a better word. Good. So I'm up here alone today because my bride woke up with a little scratchy throat and thought, you know, she probably not share that with anybody. So we appreciate her staying home, but she will be fine and healed. Amen. All right. Well, it's November, folks. Already. Somebody just slow this train down a little bit, please. It's like, what is happening? But God is still good. And so glad you're here and y'all look good. And, you know, isn't it just fun? Part of November I like because it's time to just be thankful. And just look at somebody next to you and just go, you know, I'm thankful for you. Yeah. I hope you didn't do that with an eye roll, but you actually meant that. But it truly is a time to just be thankful and remember our blessings, that God is good. And lots going on in our nation, and a lot of people are dissing America, but we need to be thankful for America. That is still the best thing going in the world. And just thank God that we live in a great nation. You could live in Somalia. How would you like that? But God put you here at such a time as this to be a part of this. So God has got some great plans for us. Amen? All right. Well, let's hold up our Bibles. I am, since Starlene isn't here, I'm like, I'm taking your iPad. It's not cracked like mine. Say, this is my Bible. I can have what it says I can have. She does this so well. I can do what it says I can do. I can be what it says I can be. Woo! Amen. Aren't you glad for the Word of God? Father, we love you. We thank you for your precious Word. It is so much more than we realize. And Father, forgive us for taking it for granted. Help us to cherish it and fill our life with your Word. And we live our life according to your Word. And we will receive the blessing and the promises of your Word. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, Pastor Shirley and I, we've started this little thing that we like doing called kind of a Maranatha update. We are living in biblical times, people. This is biblical times we are living in. And as we see Israel, you got to remember, we just kind of take for granted Israel is a nation and it's there and it's a part of our world. But just 70 years ago, Israel didn't exist. So the prophetic end time time clock began when Israel became a nation. So it's been 73 years, and we're seeing some things going on in Israel, and I just want to make you aware of some things of how real the end of the end times really is for us. So Joel chapter 3, verses 1 and 2, again, this is like prophetic 2,400 years ago, long time ago, which tells me the Bible is not a fake book. This is real. This is alive. Joel, the prophet Joel, saw the day we're living in. Unbelievable. I mean, when I think of that, I'm just like, what? So it says, at the time of those events, and he's, you know, just to catch up to speed, he's talking about our time that we live in, says the Lord, when I will restore the prosperity of Judah and Jerusalem. Judah was Israel. Israel was divided into two nations. They kind of had a civil war back then. And so anyway, but it's really just talking about the nation of Israel. He'll restore Judah and Jerusalem. Verse 2, I will gather the armies of the world into the valley of Jehoshaphat. There I will judge them for harming my people, my special possession, for scattering my people among the nations, and here's what you need to realize, for dividing up my land. Let's go to Zechariah. It's one of the last books of the Old Testament. Zechariah chapter 12, verse 3, it says, on that day I will make Jerusalem an immovable rock. All the nations will gather against it to try to move it, but they will only hurt themselves. So we need to pray for America and for revival in our nation, because more laws, more government is not going to change the hearts of people. Only God, people becoming born again and receiving Jesus Christ will change our... I know that was the case for me. Probably the case... I know Terry, dear Lord. Without Jesus, I'm telling you. He was a mess. He was telling us last night in Gig Harbor. But pray for a revival, because it literally... if it changes an individual, change a family, change a city, change a nation, right? So we need to pray for revival. So our current administration, which we need to pray for, they are trying to divide up Jerusalem. Now you got to remember, Jerusalem is God's city. It's the holy city. It's the eternal city. It belongs to God. So don't divide up Jerusalem. So our the United Nations and America is making policies to tell the Israelites to divide up Jerusalem and give half to the East Jerusalem to the Palestinians and the West Side for the Israeli people. That's a bad policy. But this is going, you're going to see this more and more in the news because the nations of the world are going to have animosity towards that little piece of real estate. It is the most contested piece of ground in the world, Jerusalem. So as you're watching the news, Israel's in the news a lot. So you know, whenever you see that, just go, this is Bible times, people. Psalms 11:3 says, if the foundations of law and order have collapsed, what can the righteous do? We're living in these days where we need to be believing God, praying, seeking, praying for revival, sharing the light of Jesus Christ every chance we get. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Love like Jesus taught us to love. It's not the time to hate. It's the time to love. It's time to be like Jesus. And faith works by love. Last night, we were in Gig Harbor. Pastor Terry preached on this message, the God kind of love. It was amazing and scared me, because this morning I'm preaching on love. And I was like, how cool is God to just put that on Pastor Terry and my heart at the same time? So if believers, as we are living in shifting times, in the shift, got to say that right, in the shift, we must not forget to love one another. Whatever your views are on masks, COVID, mandates, government policies, we must not forget to love one another. These issues can cause strong feelings one way or another, right? We've all, you know, but I think as believers, our policy is just, you know, just respect whatever your view is. You know, that's your business. That's between you and God. But we also need to remember we're family. And sometimes family doesn't see eye to eye on everything, but we're still family, and we still work and do life together. And the other thing is, don't assume that other person thinks the way you think. Pastor Starlene was with somebody, and they were just going off on a certain topic and to another person, and she knew the views of the other person, but the other person that was talking didn't realize they had an opposite of view, and she was just kind of sitting back laughing and like, I hope this doesn't go bad, and you know, but she was just kind of chuckling. But we just got to remember, we were born into the family of love. Amen. So this morning's message is going to be a little uncomfortable. Are you all right with that? You know, sometimes I would like to do it, but it's so sacrilegious, I don't want to do it. I had a youth pastor bring up a big 50-pound version Bible one time, and he's just like, how many love the Bible? We're all like, yeah, I love the Bible. How many like everything in the Bible? We're all like, yeah, we love everything. And he goes, everything? And then he's, you know, started talking about, how many love the part where it says, love your enemies? And, you know, you just hear this, And so he goes, okay. So he opens it up and just rips some pages out of the Bible. He's like, okay, now we got a good Bible, because we don't have to do that part of the Bible. And then he talked about, you know, keeping yourself pure and holy until you're married. I mean, you know, is that hard? Yeah, it's hard. Okay, we'll just rip that out so you don't have to do that anymore. You know, just kind of tore up the Bible, and pretty soon all he had left was the covers. I'd like to do that for illustration, but I don't want to do that to God's word, right? You know, it's like, oh, God, I don't want to be, you know, man, service was great. Pastor got hit by a bolt of lightning while he was preaching, you know. So, but it's kind of one of those messages today that I want to share with you. It's like, it's going to sting a little. So y'all ready for a little sting? Yeah, okay. So turn your Bibles to Luke chapter 6. Luke chapter 6, verse 27. God is good all the time. Woo, yeah. Luke chapter 6, verse 27. So this is one of those things, it's, you know, it's easier to not be a Christian. Let's just get real. I mean, to live the standard, Pastor Michael, you know, Jesus is the standard. It's like, well, pfft, failed, you know. But how many know if we're a Christian, Christian means you're a follower. It goes so strong as you are, not just I believe in Jesus, even demons believe in Jesus. It's a follower is a discipled one you are striving to be like in every way. So we Christianize things pretty broad, but the true meaning is you are a student of the life of Jesus, and you want to emulate him. That's really the true definition of a Christian, which is a tough thing to do. Are you in Luke? Luke chapter 6, verse 27 says, "But to you who are willing to listen." All right, so we got to stop right here. How many are willing to listen? I just gave you a thing. This ain't going to be fun. I'm tuning out, you know. Listening to the pregame, which don't anyone do. Listen. How many willing listeners we got this morning? Yeah, about a third. But to you who are willing to listen, I say, love your enemies. Did that hurt anyone else? Love your enemies? Are you kidding, Lord? You know, Pastor Terry was talking about forgiveness last night, and he talked about Peter just like, okay, how many times do I got to forgive? Because, you know, Peter was just kind of like said whatever he felt, no filter. And I can, in my mind, I'm thinking Peter just like, John, little punk, disciple John is on my last nerve. He thinks he's the beloved. He outruns me. So if the Lord says I got to forgive four times, I'm good with that because the fifth time, I'm going to pummel him. Because, you know, we all want a number, right? Well, how good do I got to be for how long till I don't have to be good and restrained anymore? But Jesus is saying, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who hurt you. You know, I could do without this. I was in a pastor's conference a couple years ago, and we were talking about a certain politician, and she was like, oh, I pray for him. 15 seconds is long enough for me. So I was like, okay, well, at least check that box. You know, you prayed for him. Go to Luke chapter, we're sitting in Luke, go down to the next verses. 29, Luke chapter 6, verse 29. If someone slaps you on the one cheek, hit him back. I mean, it's easier to not be, it's easier just to not live this out. It says if they slap you on the cheek, offer the other cheek also. Are you kidding me? If someone demands your coat, offer your shirt also. Give to anyone who asks, and when things are taken away from you, don't try to get them back. Do to others as you would like them to do to you. I always thought it said, do unto others before they do it to you. But, you know, not in the good way. Verse 32, if you love only those who love you, why should you get credit for that? Even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good only to those who do good to you, why should you get any credit? Even sinners do that much. This is where your Christianity rubber meets the road moment. Because everything he just told us to do is contrary to how we feel. And our Christian life isn't based upon how we feel, because we don't walk by feelings, sight. We walk by faith. So in order to live out what Jesus is telling us to do as his followers, we have to live with some help. It's really pretty hard to do this. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 41, it kind of parallels this portion in Luke, but he adds another thing. It says, whoever compels you to go 1 mile, offer to go a second mile. Now, in that culture, the Roman military would often be traveling through the roads, and they would be carrying their equipment, and if they saw you walking the same direction they were going, they would just say, hey, you, come over here. And they were vicious soldiers, so you like, yes, sir, what do you need from me? And you were hoping it was nothing much. And they would say, I need you to pick up my rucksack and carry it a mile. And that was required by the law. If a soldier asked you to do it, you had to do it. It was required 1 mile. So Jesus is saying, if they tell you to pick up their stuff and carry it, you carry it a mile, because that's what's required. But I'm telling you, go the second mile. How many times do we only do what's just required of us? We don't go the second mile. How many times in our job, I got a job description and I only do what's required, and if it's not in my job description, I ain't doing it. Yeah, but the garbage can's dumped over right in front of you and you're walking by it. What's a second mile person do? They pick it up. This is the kind of thing that Jesus talks about, and this is how, when he says, they will know you by your love for one another, he's talking about the love where you go the second mile for people. And we don't want to go the second mile for people. We don't even want to go the first mile. It's only required that we got to go the first mile. If it was up to me, I wouldn't even do a mile. Jesus is saying you're going to do 2 miles. How many know you that just kind of makes you not want to be a believer in Jesus all of a sudden? He says, but what if we only love those who are nice to us? You get no credit. Are you kidding me? It's his words. If we're only nice to nice people, there's no points for that. How are we going to reach a lost and dying world if we only are 1 mile people? How are people going to know the love of God if we don't go the extra mile with people? Jesus is saying in Luke, if you'll be kind to someone who's not kind, I'll be kind through you to them so that they will get a glimpse of how good God is. Right? Luke chapter 6, verse 34 through 36, it says, and if you lend money only to those who can repay you, why should you get credit? Even sinners will lend to other sinners for a full return. Verse 35, he repeats it again. Love your enemies. Do good to them. Lend to them without expecting to be repaid. Then your reward in heaven will be very great, and you'll be truly acting as children of the Most High. For he is kind to those who are unthankful and wicked. You know he is. You know he is. You work with some unkind, unthankful, wicked people. And you're like, dear Lord, would you just take them out for me? Sometimes I really do enjoy reading the Psalms and reading David's passions. Lord, my enemies, kill them all. Yes. I guess he can get away with that because it was before Jesus. Verse 36. You must be compassionate just as your Father is compassionate. You know, when it comes to money and our stuff, he's saying just give without strings attached. Have you ever borrowed something from somebody and they got like, okay, you borrow my stuff, this is what I expect from you. You know, and then it's like, you know, wow, okay, you know. And then they got a, you know, it's, you know, I do this for you. I'm expecting when I have a need, you're going to be there for me. And you're, you know what I mean? Got some relatives like that. You know, it's like, you know, if you just like, oh, I don't want to ask for them, but I really need that to help, you know. And it's like, is there anyone else we can ask? You know, kind of a thing. Because strings are attached. And I get it. It's your money. It's your stuff. But can you imagine people just giving you stuff and just go, do with it as you like. You know, when you're done with it, whatever. People, hey, can I borrow some money? Yeah, sure. Okay, I'll pay you back. Don't worry about paying me back. Crazy. This is a crazy kind of thing Jesus is telling us. I don't know if I can get my head around it, honestly. Trying. But this is tough. Because I live in a human body with human nature, born into a sinful world where I'm not feeling the good feelings to make me want to do these things Jesus is asking of me. In fact, most of the time, I'm wanting to do the opposite. But I want to be a follower of Jesus, so I got to discipline my life and be a follower. Right? Got a couple people following me. I lost everybody else. Great is your reward, and you're acting like your Father. And what is a name for God? What's another name for God? Terry? Love? Love? Love is another name for God. You're acting like love when you do these things. Where else is a sinner going to get it? See a glimpse of love. People are looking for love. People are looking for something they can believe in, something that's beyond normal everyday life. And God has commissioned you and me to be the behavior of God in the world today. We desperately need some people to walk in love. We need the church just to walk in love. And if the church is walking in love, when we leave these walls, our witness will be more than having to preach to somebody. It'll be about what we do. Wow. Getting a glimpse of God. I want to transition in conjunction with love, but it says there is fear. This isn't the scripture. I'm going to 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 4. But in today's life, we're fear of inflation, shortages, wars. We're hoping the malls don't run out of Christmas gifts before Christmas. Global climate change, riots, government overreach, and on and on and on. We got stuff we can get afraid of, right? But 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7 says, for God has not given us a spirit of love, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. So we got to renew our mind that I got the strength to do what God's asking me to do, because within me is power from on high, love, the God kind of love, and a sound mind. I'm not crazy. You know, I'm doing what God's called me to do. Go to Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. This is out of the Amplified. I haven't left the subject of faith, but faith and love work together. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1 says, now faith. Everyone say, now faith. Faith is right in your moment. Is the assurance, the confirmation of a title deed, of the things we hope for, being the proof of the things we do not see, and the conviction of their reality. Faith perceives as real fact what is not revealed to the senses. Ooh-wee. It's fun to walk in faith when you know that you know that you know that you know you have something before you can touch it. You got it. You just got a note of victory on the inside. You know. It is fun to live in that. And that's what he's talking about here. It's something you, spiritually, it's tangible to you. Faith is a conviction based upon knowledge that is a creative power. It's a creative force. Faith is not a denomination. Hey, what faith are you? That's not faith. Faith isn't a program, a church. It is a substance of, it's a force of power that creates things that don't exist yet, right? Go to Hebrews 11, and this trips up a lot of people because in the chapter 11 of Hebrews, we're talking about faith, and then there's verse 3, and then it goes back to talking about faith and all the people who did great things through faith, 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 through faith. It's like 23 times by faith, through faith. So we know if we're going to get anything done, we got to do it through faith. But there's this verse 3 that trips people up, and they think, why did the author leave the subject of faith? It says, by faith we understand that the worlds during the successive ages were framed, fashioned, put in order, and equipped for their intended purpose by the word of God, so that what we see was not made out of things which are visible. So it's kind of like talking about God, how he created the world and everything. But here's the reality of it. In the original language, which it was worded, that word world doesn't mean our globe, earth. It means time frames, ages ago. It literally means your world, your influence, the people that surround, circumference you is talking about. And then he goes on to talk about the age in which Moses lived, the age in which Noah, Sarah, David lived, that age, that time frame, the people he influenced, they influenced. Are you getting a picture of that? The word frame there is literally remodeled, changed the course, created something different than what was already built. And it says, by the word of God. In the Bible, we'll see word of God, and sometimes it means logos, and sometimes it means rhema. Logos is the written word of God. Rhema is a spoken word, or it's a now word. And this is a living word for now at a specific moment for a specific people. And this is what he's really trying to convey in chapter 11, that you can literally change your world, remodel it, by a now word that is living in you. So I'm thinking, if we conjunction faith with our love, are you hearing me? We can literally change our own life. We can change our marriage, our family, our kids, the people in our world, our workplace. We can do some remodeling. We can believe God for something bigger than just ourselves. We can change the world we live in by a quickened word that is alive in us. See, logos oftentimes it's black and it's on ink and we read it and it's not living in you. It's just, it's a word. It's not filled with power. But when you hear a word in you by the living God, it'll quicken you that you can do what it's telling you to do. And you can put a demand on that word because you have a substance that if I live this word, it will produce results. You will have a note of victory that if I believe God, that I can pray and believe. I don't have to preach it. I can just live it and ask God for his strength. My world, my family, my marriage, my life will be remodeled by the living word of faith that is inside of me. God is love. We can please God, but we can please love by our faith in God, our faith in love. Galatians chapter 5, verses 5 and 6. It says, for through the Spirit we eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avails anything. And really what he's talking about is following legalism and rules and a religious system of trying to be good. He's really saying that doesn't produce anything. But faith working through love, that's what works. Faith works, in the King James Bible, it says, faith works through love. Woo! Mark 11:22, it says, have faith in God. Have the God kind of faith. Have the God kind of love is another way we could literally say it without doing any damage to the scriptures. Have the God kind of love. What kind of love is that? Well, we did communion this morning. Pastor Michael did a beautiful job explaining the body and the blood of Jesus isn't just something just that we can feel good about on a Sunday morning. And like, oh, it's an example for us to live by, laying down your life. That's really what this is about. Such great love, Jesus laid down his life for you. Well, what kind of love is that? That's crazy love. That's the God kind of love. That's what's called agape love. Agape love. Everyone say agape. Agape you. The reference, this God kind of love. We need to have faith in the God kind of love. The definition of it is love unconcerned with the self and concerned with the greatest and highest good of another. So if we just remember Luke chapter 6, love your enemies, pray for those that slap you, you offer your cheek. And the God kind of love says, I'm not concerned about me, but I'm more concerned about your highest good. Oh my goodness. Agape is from the will. It is a choice demonstrated through action. Agape requires faithfulness and a commitment of sacrifice without expecting anything in return. I'm just saying, what if marriages were built on that kind of love? We wouldn't see any divorces. God set the standard. Romans chapter 5, verse 8, it says, but God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. What? In other words, you didn't like God, you didn't know God, you didn't care about God, but even when you were ignorant about God, he was proactive and he sent somebody to you to save you. His name is Jesus because he loves you and he doesn't want you to go to hell. Jesus taught this so many places. I just want to illustrate some stuff. Brother Ryan, could you come on up here for a minute? So if you just lay down right here, lay down. And just kind of look like you're suffering. It's a bad day. It's a bad day. So Jesus talked about the Good Samaritan, right? Well, the Good Samaritan is a description of the God kind of love in action. And I hate that Jesus uses this, but basically he's saying, here's a man, and he used the context of a racial issue. He was a Samaritan. And the guys that walked by were, he was a Jew, wasn't he? He was a Jew that was suffering. And other Jews came by. And the first Jew that came by was a pastor. Came by and went, ooh, that dude's big, and maybe this might be a trap. He's going to rip my face off. And I'm clean, and I don't want to touch anything that would mess up my nice clothes today. I'm going to church. So on my way to church, I don't want to get involved in something messy. Then the other guy came by and was just like, I don't got time for this. I got appointments. And just leaves this guy suffering. Suffering. And somebody who was of a different ethnicity, the Samaritan, who wasn't even supposed to talk to the Jews, was just like, the most unlikely person came and went, dude, are you, man, you are hurting. He was hurting so much, it inconvenienced him that he had to take him and put him in his own mode of transportation, a donkey, and take him to a hotel room so the guy could get some rest and healed up, and sent doctors to the room to administer health. And the guy that wasn't even supposed to, that there was racial conflict between them, said, you know, whatever the bill is, I'll pay it. This guy needs help. Jesus is really teaching us a lesson in the agape kind of love. And today, what we could do is just go, you know, could you just hold this up in your suffering? That political. You know, oh, this guy is of a different political view than me. He doesn't deserve anything I could do for him because he doesn't vote the way I vote. He doesn't see government the way it should be. So I don't like you. Good luck, buddy. Is that the God kind of love? No, it's not. Thank you. Stay suffering. We're not done with you. How about this one? Vaccination. Oh, no. Dear Lord, we're not going there, are we? Yeah, we're going there. Because there's so much stupidity over this subject today. And we avoid people no matter what their persuasions are because they don't see that it should be done this way. Just because they got a different opinion than you doesn't mean our love stops here. Our Mother Teresa, unbelievable woman. If you ever study the, I encourage you, read her biography. I hope it changes your life. Because this woman was in Calcutta, India, with people who literally had open sores of leprosy. You don't want to touch people with open sores of leprosy. She would literally touch them and hug them and minister the love of God and never got sick. I think if we operate in the God kind of love, some of the things we're hoping for, dude, I love you. I'm glad you're not suffering. I've got your back. You're good. Thank you. Nice little nap. You know, sometimes it's okay to take a nap in church. But love, the God kind of love, just looks past some of the things of the moment that we're so concerned about, and we even have to can put stuff on the shelf. I love you no matter what. You're a person. God told me to. Sometimes you don't, you know, you can love even when you don't feel like it. Come on. You can be mad at somebody. Oh, man, I can't believe they did this. And you got an opportunity to talk to them. Pastor Terry, come on, walk up here. I'm so mad at him. I'm so mad at him. Man. God loves you. Amen? Might as well just stay here. We'll just close this thing out. But the God kind of love, you mentioned yesterday, the God kind of love compels us to do things. Another word is the God kind of love constrains us. It constrains us. It's like a magnet. We're drawn to certain things, and we're compelled, we're constrained to do stuff. There's a parameter in which our love runs, a lane we go in, because it constrains us to stay in the God's kind of love lane. Wow. And we're working in love with faith. Next week, I'm going to tell you some benefits that we're believing God for so many things, but I think sometimes there's a barrier between us and God because we're not operating in the God kind of love. And God wants to bless us and shower us. And in a day of famine and persecution and people are stupid and ugly, you can be blessed and joyful and happy and good looking and prospering when everyone else is stressed out and worried. And if we'll walk in love, you will have an open heaven over your life. Let's stand. Woo! Heavenly Father, we just come before you in the mighty, gracious name of Jesus Christ. We thank you for the power of God that you compelled us to come to you by your love, your goodness, by giving us precious promises of eternal life, saving us when we couldn't save ourselves, loving us when we were unlovely. You are agape love to me. If you're here this morning or watching online and Jesus Christ is not the Lord of your life, you have not just surrendered and committed to Jesus, today's the day. Don't go another. This is the day. Today's it. Don't put it off. Why are you putting it off? You think you give your life to God, he's going to send you somewhere you don't want to go? No. He's going to take you to places. Jesus is good. His plans for you are great. He wants to bless you. Why are you holding your blessing back? Surrender to the Lord. I just want to give you an opportunity. If you're here, count of three, just raise your hand. Just say, I need Jesus. And you do. Watch it online. One, God is good. He's been chasing you. Just give up. Be the best decision you do. Two, don't talk yourself out of the best decision you'll make. Three, respond. Raise your hand right now. In this place, online. Amen, amen. Praise God. Yes. Yes, yes, yes. In a minute, Pastor Terry's going to lead us in a prayer and close out the service, but maybe you're here and you're a believer and you're just like, you're seeing the Word of God and challenged by agape love. To love by going the extra mile, the second mile. Not just doing what's required, but putting yourself down so you can show the love of God. Is that you in this place? Just need prayer. Lord, take me to a whole nother place in love. Help me to be the God kind of love. Okay, I'm going to raise my hand. Nobody else is because I need help because this is a big order. It's a big order. It's a big order. Pastor Terry, would you lead people in the sinner's prayer and pray for us to have the strength to live in the God kind of love? Close out the service.
Well, Father, I just thank you for each and every person here today. It was love that came down, that became a man, that laid down his life, that we could be redeemed. It was your love that sent your only son to the cross, that we could be translated out of darkness and into this marvelous light. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your obedience. We thank you for your unfailing love that you poured out your blood for each and every one of us. That we could be saved, we could be redeemed, we could be healed and delivered and set free, that we would not have to endure 1 minute in hell. Father, we thank you. We thank you for your goodness. And Father, I just pray over each and every person. As Romans 5:5 says, that the love of God has been poured out. It has been shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. Lord, I pray that you would quicken it, that you would awaken it on the inside of us. That unlike any other love in this world, your love is supernatural. And it is through the power of your Holy Spirit that even gives us the ability to walk in that God kind of love. So, Lord, I thank you that we can couple faith and love together. That our love can grow stronger so that our faith can soar, so that our prayers can be answered, so that the promises of God, which are yes and amen, can come to pass in our lives. Father, we just thank you that you live in us, that love lives in us. Lord, quicken that reality on the inside of us. That it's not about behavior modification, but it's about heart transformation. Lord, I pray right now that you work out of us what needs to be worked out. The offenses, the bitterness, the unforgiveness. The enemy is working tirelessly to keep us out of love. Why? Because he knows that's the power. That's the power source. That is our access to the throne room. So, Lord, I just thank you right now. Lord, that the love of God is rising up on the inside of us. And God, that you empower us by your grace to step out, Lord, as you lead us to demonstrate your love in the lives of others. Lord, we thank you for those opportunities. We thank you for those open doors to be your light and to be your witness. For it is the love of God that will show the world that we are yours. And Lord, we thank you that you don't ask us to do anything that you won't empower us to do. So Lord, we call upon your grace and your strength to walk in your love each and every day. And we thank you for it in advance, and we give you praise and glory in Jesus' mighty name. Everybody said, amen. Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes. Cause I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs. Tell me, is it